Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Boudica, Dreaming the Eagle, written by Manda Scott and read by Liza Goddard, Philip Stevens, and Jerome Flynn.
Eagle. Boudica Dreaming, Book One. Listen to me. I am Luain Mac Calmer, once of Hibernia, now of Mona, which lies in the mist seas of the west. I dream the songlines of our people, and I bring the greatest of these to you now, that you may know the way of things. It is clear that we stand at a point of turning upon which our future rests. Our greatness is diminished, stolen by men of war and avarice. Much is misremembered. Much is spoken that is untrue. But I swear to you that I speak truth, and I speak it now, in the dark before the fire. Only listen, and you shall know all that you have been, and, if we hold true, can be once again. Full-hearted, clear-hearted, strong-hearted, together and alone. We live on a land where the dream runs deep in the earth. River and mountain, forest and shore, each of these is alive with the spirits of place that, together, we call gods. For untold generations, the gods of this land held our people in their care, your ancestors and mine. Breaca, the threefold mother, held them through birth and death, and the sharp moments of danger when the walls between the worlds grow thin. Namain, her daughter, who waxes and wanes with the tides, gave light at night and offered succor to those who walked the ways of the dreamtime. Her brother, Belin, the sun, warmed them, and his cousin, Mananan of the seas, showed them the whale roads of travel, fed them, held them, swept away their cares. Over time, the ancestors came to understand that Mona, this island that lies in between Hibernia and Albion, was a place where dreams are seen most clearly. Here, at the edge between the worlds, songs are caught amongst the oaks, and warriors learn the truth of themselves that is only otherwise revealed in battle. For 1,000 generations, the tribes of all the world have selected the best amongst their young people and sent them across land and sea to the oak groves of Mona to learn this one truth, that the world is a web of living being and we are small motes within it. Only open your hearts and you shall know the gift of its vitality. Over countless years this was taught, and it was learned. And in the learning was wisdom and peace and a flourishing unmatched across the world. And yet, the shadow of Rome fell across us, and now it grows again in strength. 100 years ago, Julius Caesar came to pillage, sent by greed and a thirst for the empty vanity of power. Mananan, god of the sea, was strong in our defense. Twice did Caesar sail, and twice did his ships encounter storms the likes of which none alive had seen. Twice did he land bedraggled and sick, so that the best he could do was strike a small treaty with the tribes of the south, who saw no danger in trading with a man who could not read the seas. Thus was Rome defeated. But now, 100 years later, we see that nation flex its muscles once again, and in its avarice is a bleakness of destruction, of false gods and a sundering of all we hold sacred. To turn back this tide of iron and pain, we of Mona must needs find a hero such as was sung of in the old times. These are few, and yet, from amongst the many thousands of dreams, has emerged a thread of possibility. It branches often, and some of those branches wither and die. But there are two that flourish, and if either of these bears fruit, our land will live these 10,000 years under the care of the elder gods. Listen, then, to the first seeds of the stream, to the shoots and branches and fluttering leaves. For here is a story of warriors and dreamers, singers and heroes, such as the world has need of now, more than ever before.
Acknowledgement. Any work of this nature requires an extraordinary amount of background material. I would like to thank the following for their expert advice and assistance: Dr. Jilly Carr, Dr. John Coe, Philip Crummy, Dr. J. D. Hill, Professor Lawrence Kepi, and Owen Thompson, all of whom gave freely of their time and expertise, and those members of the Brit Arch Internet mailing list who so often supplied answers to mundane questions. Most especial thanks to H.J.P., Douglas, Arnold, astronomer and formerly Primus Pilus in the Legio Secunda Augusta reenactment group, who provided continual support and invaluable comments throughout. As is always the case, any technical faults are entirely mine, as is the interpretation of the facts supplied. Thanks also to Jane Judd, my agent, and Selena Walker at Transworld for having faith from the beginning, and to Kate Miziak and Nita Taublib at Bantam US for their support and enthusiasm. Particular thanks to Leo, who introduced me to the dreaming, and to Carol, Hilary, Elliot, and Ken, amongst others, who showed me how to live it. Prologue, Autumn AD 32. The attack came in the hour before dawn. The girl woke to the stench of burning thatch and the sound of her mother screaming. Outside, in the clearing beyond the hut, she heard her father's response and the clash of iron on bronze. Another man shouted, "Not her father," and she was up, throwing off the hides, reaching back into the dark behind the sleeping place for her skinning knife, or, better, her axe. She found neither. Her mother screamed again, differently. The girl scrabbled frantically, feeling the fire scorch her skin and the sliding ache of fear that was the threat of a sword cut to the spine. Her fingers closed on a haft of worn wood, running down to the curve of a grip she knew from hours of oil and polish and the awe of youth. Her father's boar spear. She jerked it free, turning and pulling the leather cover from the blade in one move. A wash of pre-dawn light hit her eyes as the door skin was ripped from its hangings and replaced as rapidly by a shadow. The bulk of a body filled the doorway. Dawn light flickered on a sword blade. Close by, her father screamed her name, "Breaca!" She heard him and stepped out of the dark. The warrior in the doorway grinned, showing few teeth, and lunged forward. His blade caught the sunlight and twisted it, blinding them both. Without thinking, she did as she had practiced in her mind, in the safety of the lower horse paddocks, and once in the forest beyond. She lunged in return, putting the weight of her shoulders, the twist of her back, and the straightening kick of both legs into the thrust of the weapon. She aimed for the one pale segment of skin she could see. The spear blade bit and sank into the notch of his throat, at the place where the tunic stopped and the helmet had not yet begun. Blood sluiced brightly downwards. The man choked and stopped. The sword that sought her life came slicing on, carried by the speed of his lunge. She wrenched sideways, too slowly, and felt the sting of it carve between her fingers. She let go of the spear. The man toppled over, angled away from her by the weight of the haft. The doorway brightened and darkened again. Her father was there. Breaca, God, Breaca. He too stopped. The man on the floor pushed a hand beneath his side and tried to rise. Her father's hammer sang down and stopped him forever. He brought his arms up and round her, holding her close, smoothing her cheek, running his big, broad smith's fingers through her hair. You killed him. My warrior. My best girl. You killed him. Gods, that was good. I could not bear to lose you both. He was rocking her back and forth as he had when she was a small child. He smelled of blood and stomach acid. She pushed her arms down his front to make sure that he was whole and found that he was. She tried to squirm free to look at the rest of him. He leaned in closer and his breathing changed, and she felt wet warmth slide down her neck to the wing of her shoulder and from there down the flat plane of her chest. She let him hold her then, while he wept, and didn't ask him why her mother had not come in with him to find her. Her mother, who carried his child. The stomach acid was her mother's. She lay near the doorway, and she too carried a spear in her hand. She had used it once to good effect, but they had been two against her one, and the child she carried within had slowed her turn. The slice of the blade had opened her from chest bone to hips, spilling out all that had been inside. Breaca crouched down beside her. The tentative light of the new day brought colour where before there had been none. She reached down to the small, crinkled thing lying at her mother's side and turned it over. Her father was behind her. Would have been a boy, she said. I know. He let his hand rest on her shoulder. His fingers were still. His weeping had stopped. He knelt down and hugged her, fiercely. His chin pressed on her head, and the burr of his voice rocked through her neck to her chest as he spoke. What need have I of another son, when I have a daughter who can face an armed warrior and live? His voice was warm, and there was pride in the wretched grief. And she had not the strength to tell him that she had acted out of instinct, not courage or a warrior's heart. Her mother had been leader of the Eceni, firstborn of the royal line, and she was honoured in death as she had been in life. Her body was bound in fine linen and hides, closing the child back into her abdomen. The platform was built of hazel and elm, and the body raised onto it, lifting her closer to the gods and out of reach of wolf and bear. The three dead warriors of the Koritani, who had broken the laws of the gods in killing a woman in childbirth, and of the elders in killing the leader of a neighbouring tribe without fair battle, were stripped and dragged to the forest to feed whatever found them first. Breaca was given the sword from the one she had killed. She didn't want it. She gave it to her father, who broke it across his forging block and said he would make her a better one, full-sized, for when she was grown. In its stead, Ermid, one of the older girls, gave her a crow's feather with the quill dyed red and bound round with blue horsehair, the mark of a kill. Her father showed her how to braid her hair at the sides as the warriors do for battle, with the feather hanging free at her temple. In the late morning, Iborovic, warrior and smith of the Eceni, took his daughter to the river to wash her clean of the blood of battle and bind the cut on her hand, and then walked her back to the roundhouse, to the care of Macha, her mother's sister, the mother of Bon, his first and only living son.
Part 1. Spring to Autumn, AD 33. Chapter 1. Bon had the dream for the first time when he was 8 years old. In the spring after Breaca lost her mother and got a sword cut on her hand. He woke suddenly and lay sweating under the hides, his eyes searching the dark of the roof space for comfort. A long time ago, when he was younger and afraid of the night, his father had carved the marks of horse, bear, and wren on the crooked beam above his bed to keep him safe. He had spent light summer evenings tracing them in his mind, feeling the wall of their protection. Now he lay in the pressing silence, praying for light, and saw nothing. If the moon had risen, it did not shine on his side of the roundhouse. If there were stars, their light did not penetrate the thatch. Inside, the cooling embers of the fire gave off a thread of smoke, but no flame. It was the blackest night he could ever remember, and he might as well have been blind, or still dreaming. He did not want to be dreaming. Blinking, he searched for other ways to anchor himself in the world of the living. Light, dry smoke tickled his nose. Each night, his mother laid a tent of twigs on the embers, that the smoke of their burning might carry her family safely through the world beyond sleep. With age, he was beginning to understand the language of the smoke. He breathed in and let the different tones filter through his head, sorting them into an order that would speak to him. The acerbic touch of sun-scorched grass, the warmer, more sinuous thread of acorns roasting, the pricking of wet shale, and the high, clear note of tannin, as from a hide freshly cured. It was this last one that fixed it. An image came of a girl lying asleep under a scattering of white petals, and, later, of a tree dripping red with berries the color of dried blood that he had been told not to eat. Hawthorn. It would have been that. He made his body relax. He was calmer now. His heart beat less hard. He closed his eyes and let the drifting smoke carry him back to the start of the dream. In the other world, it was daytime. He was riding a strange horse, not one of his father's, a red mare with a hide the color of a fox in winter. She was tall and very fit. He ran his hand down the length of her neck, and her coat sparked like a new coin beneath his fingers. They were running fast, at dream speed. He was naked, and the mare had no saddlecloth. He could feel the bunch of her muscles gather and pull beneath his thighs. If he worked to let go of this world, he could see the steam billow back from her nostrils and hear the whistle of her breath over the splashing hammer of hooves on turf and bog. In a while, she passed out of the sunlight and entered a mist so thick he could barely see the tips of her ears. The fog swirled in banners past his eyes, making him blind. He sucked in a breath and smelled horse sweat and stale bog water and the mint-sour tang of myrtle crushed underfoot. Without any good reason, he lifted one hand and cupped it round his mouth and yelled a word, a name, into the dizzying white. His voice came out harshly like a raven's, and the name itself made no shape in his head. It echoed and came back to him and still made no sense. He let it go and leaned forward instead, singing to the red mare, urging her on, promising her fame and long life and strong foals if she carried them both safely through the danger. There was certainly danger. Both of them felt it. A distant malevolence kept at bay only by their speed. The mare flicked her eyes back to listen and then cocked them suddenly forward. The boy felt a change in her stride and looked up. Ahead of him, a fallen yew blocked the path. The mare gathered herself and tucked her head in, shortening her stride. He wrapped the fingers of both hands tight in the snaking red of her mane, feeling the coarse cut of the hair on his palms. She jumped cleanly, and he saw.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.